All right. Welcome to Amplify Women in Research. I'm very excited today to have Dr. Catherine Akerman with us. Dr. Akerman is from she's the medical director of the Female Athlete Program in the Division of Sports Medicine at Boston Children's Hospital, associate director of the Sports Medicine Endocrine Lab at Massachusetts General Hospital, assistant professor of Harvard Medical School, and a team physician for USA Rowing. Very cool and impressive stuff. Thank you for being here today, Dr. Akerman.
Thank you for having me.
So the cool positions that you hold and really fun stuff, and I know our students would be so excited to hear about being a team physician for USA Rowing, for example. What drew you into sports medicine in the first place?
So I was a rower. I still am a rower. I was a member of the US rowing team, and our team physician back then is still one of our team physicians. Dr. Jo Hannafin is a female surgeon in New York. And so I remember being on the team and being really excited that you could be a female doctor in sports medicine. And I really wasn't sure that I wanted to be a surgeon. I actually was more drawn to internal medicine, and she inspired me that you could do that as well, even though she was a surgeon. So I got drawn into sports medicine because I was an athlete, and I was very excited about female athlete issues. And I was very interested in trying to make a career out of that, which I managed to figure out how to do.
Awesome. Yeah, it's awesome to be able to sort of continue your work, and you have that lived experience to bring forward, right? Which must be really to relate to the athletes that you work with.
Yeah, I think it definitely helps to be an active person when you're in the field of sports medicine. It gives you a little bit more credibility, and it also makes it fun.
Yeah, for sure. Tell us a little bit about some of your most cited work and the research that you've done.
So I'd say probably our most cited paper was a survey that we did of 1,000 female athletes. And I got involved with the International Olympic Committee and their concept of relative energy deficiency in sport. And when they first put out that statement about beds back in 2014, there was some discussion that all the different aspects of relative energy deficiency hadn't been proven as well. So there are various health and performance consequences of relative energy deficiency. So I thought it would be really interesting to actually survey female athletes coming into a sports clinic and asking them about different aspects of health and performance that were affected after surveying them about different energy deficiency and disordered eating patterns. And so after we surveyed these 1,000 athletes, we actually found that a lot of those relative energy deficiency health and performance consequences were quite prevalent in our population. And so it just added a little bit more data to the concept of REDS, and we've continued to run with REDS and further explore the hematologic effects, the metabolic effects, some of the performance effects, and it gave us more information to talk about with the athletes who were not eating enough. It wasn't just about bone density and menstrual dysfunction, which is super important, but also about the health and performance consequences that they may also be feeling.
Must be so you must be wanting to do all sorts of research studies all the time, talking to patients and having an athlete yourself and knowing other athletes. You must hear sort of complaints or symptoms that, you know, come up often and want to answer research questions all the time. How do you sort of pick and choose which ones to go with?
I think that's really the benefit of doing translational research. You know, a lot of people really focus in on basic research, or they focus in on being a clinician and doing clinical medicine. And it's very hard to kind of find that balance of how much to do research and how much to do clinical. That's why I like to work in interdisciplinary teams. So I work with a lot of PhDs. I work with basic scientists. I work with people that do translational work. And being in clinic just helps, like you said, think of the questions that need to be answered, finding out the things that are most pertinent to athletes. And when I start to feel a theme and I look at the literature and it's not there, then I get excited to explore it. And I've been really lucky to be able to go around the world and meet awesome people that are doing work in different aspects and try to bring them together so that I can have collaborators from all over the place kind of working on the same issues together.
Is there a project that sort of came out of that curiosity and conversations with patients or athletes that you thought was going to be a game changer and then didn't quite take off the way you wanted it to?
Well, I think with studying female athletes, it always gets a little more complicated because women, to study them correctly, are expensive. So we have menstrual cycles, and it's very hard to control for the phase of the menstrual cycle to do that properly. So I'd say we're getting there. We've been looking for funding. We've recently found some great funding opportunities to really study in-depth hormonal changes that are happening so that we can better inform female athlete patients what's happening across their menstrual cycle. So I think we're just at the cusp of some really great things happening. And like I said, doing collaborative work and getting the best people in the world to come together because we're finally finding the funding sources to do it correctly.
Yeah, so key, eh? It's definitely not something you think about as much as a grad student. It's the funding. Yeah. You have the best ideas in the world, but someone's got to fund it, right?
Exactly.
Years to get programs up and running, to get the pilot data, to really convince people that this is an area worth funding, eh?
Yeah, we started way back with a female athlete conference, partially to raise money to do research. So that was the idea was, okay, if this isn't going to be, you know, funded by the NIH right away, because there are really other very important projects that need to be funded. And so sports medicine is not at the top of the list. Then let's figure out who's engaged and interested in female athletes. And then let's have them come to a conference and share ideas and figure out how to pool resources and raise money from the conference so that we can actually put that towards research, which is what we've been doing for the last 7 years. So that was where we got our start. And now it's gotten more attention and drawing in bigger funds.
That's a fantastic idea to create like a niche conference like that, because it builds such fantastic collaborations as well.
Yeah, the people we meet along the way has been wonderful.
So is there a project that you're doing currently that you think is going to have like a significant impact moving forward in your field?
Well, we're designing a project right now to actually do more prospective work with relative energy deficiency. So following female athletes and not doing so many correlations, but actually trying to understand when energy deficiency starts to hit, what are the different systems that kind of fall off first? We know that when somebody's really energy deficient, for example, anorexia nervosa, there's many different systems that are hindered. We also know that female athletes and even male athletes go through phases of energy deficiency, particularly in high performance as they're getting ready for something or if they need to make a certain weight category. We're trying to understand is what are those little changes that happen? How detrimental are they? And are there phases that you can go into energy deficiency just briefly and it's not a major health consequence? So that's the part that we're working on now, is kind of finding those subtle differences and finding what's really detrimental and what isn't.
That'll be amazing. What's the recruitment target for that type of project?
What is the what target? I'm sorry?
Recruitment target.
Oh, so it's women and men, and it's we're working with elite athletes.
Cool. So this is really interesting stuff. I feel like I could ask a few more questions just for personal interest, because it's so interesting when you're a woman and you exercise or you do any type of sport, there's all sorts of things that come up and you go to the literature and there's no real answers. So we often kind of joke about like, you learn about these things by talking to other active women, right? And like, oh, you have to do this because you have this. And so it's nice to hear that there's people out there who are working on the literature base, so we actually have some evidence-based medicine in this area.
So right. There's so many projects to do. There's so many questions, pregnancy questions, postpartum questions, perimenopausal questions, menopausal questions. These are all sort of topics that used to be taboo, but there's so many active women throughout the lifespan now that we have to get the answers.
Absolutely. So just to wrap things up, do you have a message for early career women in sport research in particular that you'd like to share?
I think that women should figure out the topic that they're passionate about and not get discouraged. I had a very weird path and an interesting combo doing sports medicine and endocrinology. And initially people thought I was crazy. And now people think it's genius, because they say, well, actually you do need to understand hormones if you're going to be talking about physiology in women. And so it was a nice thing that sort of gave me a niche, and as I sort of saw the vision early on and wasn't dissuaded, that helped me to get here. So I think if people have a really good research question or a very passionate topic, if they really feel passionate about it, they should keep running with it and not be discouraged because someone hasn't.
Yeah, well, it just goes to show you were passionate about what you're doing, and you know, it led to the development of that conference and collaborations and grants, and it like you said, it sort of directed your whole career pathway, which is awesome.
Yeah, and I'd also say, always share the wealth. There's so many people that you can collaborate with, and you will find that it's really fun to work with others in a team if you're grabbing other people's expertise, and the project will be that much stronger. So never be afraid to pull people in and kind of work together.
Yeah, it totally changes everything when you find the right person to collaborate with. It doesn't feel as difficult to get through reviews and to get through recruitment or whatever the challenges are, right? Because you have someone in it with you.
Exactly. And you can't know everything. So you got to trust your colleagues and friends that they have a skill set that you don't, and you'll be stronger together.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for doing this. This was really interesting. And I'm really looking forward to seeing more of your work and learning more from it. From a personal perspective, my research isn't in this area, but I think from a personal perspective, lots of women are very excited to see the work that you're putting out. So thank you for taking the time to do this.
Thank you. Thank you for doing this work yourself.
Thanks.